expect your patients to be a good listener. Okay, so on this platform, first of all, I would like to thank Analytics India magazine for creating this platform. This is a learning platform for not only for you guys, this is for each one of us here. I would like to thank each one of you to be available and to take out time from your busy schedule and to learn from all the speakers here. Not only this, I would like to thank all the speakers who have created this platform, a knowledge warehouse. Okay, so today I'll be sharing my views on, is there a real world role of artificial intelligence and machine learning in cancer diagnosis? Am I audible? Okay, so contents of this presentation would be AIML in cancer diagnosis, validation versus real world usage, because we really need to understand if the products when they are coming in the market and the products when they are in the validation state, you know, so how they are aiding in the clinical decision making and extent of real world use of AIML in cancer diagnosis, conclusions and way ahead. Okay, so I know that since morning we all are listening about artificial intelligence and all its basics, but I'll just brush up all of the jargons. Okay, so artificial intelligence is a term which is originated by John McCarthy in 1956. Okay, and how we have used this, because there are complex human intelligent behavior problems. With the help of artificial intelligence, we are trying to solve these problems. Okay, so in all the fields, the way we have seen since morning, AI has come up in all the verticals and all other different horizons. Same way AI has come in the medical field as well. So AI improves the diagnosis in terms of efficiency and accuracy. So how do we calculate the performance of AI in terms of efficiency and accuracy? When it comes to the efficiency in terms of sensitivity, specificity, positive prediction value and negative prediction value. In coming slides, we'll see that how we calculate those values. In healthcare, there are lot many areas wherein artificial intelligence has taken its place. Radiology, pathology, ophthalmology, cardiology, and oncology, just to name a few. So here we'll be discussing about how artificial intelligence is working in the real world for cancer diagnosis. Okay. This is just the overview how this thing has evolved. Okay, so initially these expert systems came into picture. So what these expert systems used to do, expert systems are nothing but where in physician decisions are coded into executable set of forms. Okay, so how it used to happen, there are patients, they do come with their complaints, doctor examine the patients, they order some tests, on the basis of test results, they enter that data into the expert system. Same way doctor give their own findings, and this way diagnosis used to take place. When it comes to machine learning, what machine learning does? Machine learning is known as a very successful branch of artificial intelligence. In this, patient will come with their complaints, and with the help of machine learning protocol, system is able to identify the hidden patterns. So when it comes to do the diagnosis, okay, diagnosis can be at any stage, be it the pre-operative stage or the intraoperative stage. In terms of when we need to identify the image for the image detection and for disease diagnosis and drug discovery. In all of the fields, machine learning has taken its place. These all are the terminologies what we are using since morning, but I'll just name a few from here. What is deep learning? Deep learning is again a subset of the machine learning, and this is basically used to analyze the large data sets. And what is artificial neural network and convoluted neural network? So basically these are again part of deep learning. And the way in our brains, neurons are there. Same way in artificial neural network, there are nodes are there in the artificial neural network. What they do? To identify the hidden complex patterns, we use artificial neural network. And to classify those images, we use convoluted neural network. So when we use convoluted neural network, it just doesn't classify the image. It actually reads the image in the form of pixel format. And it reads the lines and even images, lines and what all, curves also in the images. Other examples for AI technology is Bayesian network, decision table, KFD, Kerner-Fisher discriminant, K-nearest neighbor, natural language processing, random forest, and so on. So when it comes to the Bayesian network, what it does, this is basically used to calculate the probability. When we are seeing the probability, that means it computes the probability of prediction of the various diseases. When it comes to decision table, what decision table does, it contains conditional control statements. This is again used for probability and decision making in healthcare system. Kerner facial discriminant, this is used for face recognition and feature extraction. K nearest neighbor, this is again used, and this algorithm basically assumes close things happens in the close proximity. Natural language processing, the way Manish has already discussed, random forest, this is again versatile in nature. This is basically used not only for binary values, this is used for categorical function as well. And support vector machine, this is again for classification and regression analysis. So in short, all these technologies are used for classification and regression analysis. Okay, so when we'll see AIML in the cancer diagnosis, we would like to see that globally 1 out of 6 deaths that are happening is due to cancer. In case if you like to see the WHO records, you can see that 9.6 million deaths are happening across the world due to cancer. Same way in India, these are 7.84 lakh deaths are happening due to cancer. So now we need to see how AI can help in diagnosis cancer and how we can prevent, in case if we'll be able to diagnose cancer at initial stage, how we'll be able to prevent cancers. Okay, so now we can see that a large number of AIML protocols for cancer diagnosis are currently in various stages of development and validation across the world. So now when we are saying that there are validation and development across the world, but there is very important point to be noticed, till the time this is not quality assessed, these products should not come in the market. And why this, they should not come in the market, we'll talk on these in detail. Okay, so basically we judge the performance of our protocol on the basis of sensitivity, specificity, positive prediction value and negative prediction value. Now we need to see how we calculate these values. So here we are taking an example wherein a patient is having the disease, patient, they don't have the disease, the test is coming as positive or the test is coming as negative. Okay, so in this basis, these values will come up. So when we calculate sensitivity, so that means we'll take proportion of people who have the disease with a positive test. So sensitivity will come out as number of patients with disease with positive test results divided by total number of patients with the disease. So this way, in case if we'll say the true positive is 90 and the false negative is 10. So what is the probability of the patients, they'll be having a disease. So that means the true positive will be coming as 90% here. Same way, we'll be calculating the specificity. And the specificity will be proportion of people. Here, one second. Let me go back. Yeah, and the specificity will be proportion of people who don't have the disease and the test will come out as negative. So the number of patients without disease with negative test results divided by false positive plus true negatives. So this way the value of specificity will come out. Positive prediction value, same way, proportion of people for whom the test is coming out as positive and they have the disease. So that means true positive divided by true positive plus false positive. This will come out as positive prediction value, and the negative prediction value will be proportion of people for whom the test is coming out as negative and they have the disease. So that means false negative divided by false negative plus true negative. Okay, so ideally, what's the outcome here? The outcome is ideally a good test should have high sensitivity, high specificity, high positive prediction value, and high negative prediction value. Okay. With this flowchart, what we are trying to figure out, we are trying to figure out how we do the validation of such tests. So what we'll do, we'll take the patient data set, okay, and how we'll be validating whether the AI ML protocol is really good to use or not. So we'll be taking the raw AIML protocol based data, we'll be taking this into the training set using patient data set. So once the data set will be trained, we'll be using this trained AIML protocol into validation set. Once this will be validated, this will go into testing set, and once this will be tested, in that case this will be ready for clinical use. So the point to notice here is once the data set is, the AIML protocol is just validated, we will compare this with the gold standard. And while comparing this with the gold standard, this will not be used to make clinical decisions over here. And this is a point to notice. Even if AIML protocol is validated but not tested, so that means that is not ready for clinical use. Okay, I'll share a few examples here how AIML protocol is being used by big giants so far. Okay, so in case if we'll take the example of Microsoft, what Microsoft is developing, they have developed a computer system in the form of cell. So that will be inserted in the human cells, and once the cancer will be detected, that cancerous cells will be depleted, that afflicted by the computer. Okay, so this is the kind of technology what Microsoft is trying to come up with. Same way, IBM Watson, they are coming up with the evidence-based treatment recommendation. So what they will do on the basis of electronic medical record, using natural language processing, they will be giving the recommendations. Okay, what Cisco is doing with Circadia. So they are trying to come up with an IT bra. So what that bra will do, basically, they will detect the cancerous cells. In case if there is change in the temperature of the breast tissues, this will identify and this will detect the early detection of breast cancer. Same way, these are just few of the examples what we have quoted here. Apart from that, even Amazon and Google, they are also coming up with a lot of innovations in the healthcare sector. Since the validation tests, they are conducted in the experimental conditions, okay, using retrospective patient database, they are prone to selection bias. So now, when we are saying that the retrospective data set, that means they are already using the data sets for which the testing have already been done. Okay, so here, there is a selection bias. And now when we are saying that what is selection bias, so that means there is no randomization and there is no randomization selection of the data. So when we are already, there is a bias in selecting the data, then definitely there will be, even the output will be customized. Okay, so when we really need to judge the performance of AIML, then we need to see that in the real world setting. So now here with the examples, we can see that when this is the standardized data set, the cancerous chances of cancerous is benign and malignant, and this is the borderline. But in the real world setting, in case if we'll see that, this is quite varied. So on that basis, you know, these are just the basics what I tried to cover up, and now I'll be sharing our research, what we have done. And we are trying to figure out the real-world role of AIML in cancer diagnosis, and which can help and aid in the clinical decision-making. Okay, so this is the scoping review what we have conducted using PRISMA protocol, and PICO is the approach what we have used. So before starting with our research, I would like to specify that we have used a very specific criteria for our research. PubMed is the database which is freely accessible that we have used for our research. In that way, data we extracted, we taken out the eligible articles, compiled them, and there is no statistical analysis was performed. So this is basically the inclusion and exclusion criteria what we have taken into consideration for our study. Okay, so now the way I talked about PICO is the population, intervention, comparator, and outcomes. When I say that inclusion criteria, we have already taken humans into consideration with any type of cancer. And we have excluded all different non-humans category who don't have cancer. Intervention, our criteria is to figure out AIML protocol used for diagnosis. Okay, and we have excluded AIML protocol used for anything other than diagnosis. In the comparator, we have used any comparator, outcome, what is our study aim. And study design is prospective patient enrollment, and exclusion is all other type of studies. Language, we have taken only English into consideration because our researchers are quite proficient in English language only. Okay, so in the studies, so these are the same criteria is being discussed. Okay, and how we have taken, so we curated the data and we extracted the data from different review articles, and we have taken in a particular set of database, and that's how we have conducted this study. So what we did, we ran our search strategy in PubMed. That's the database, and for that we have taken all those studies into consideration till 6th Jan 2020. So we have taken these many research, all retrieved records were scanned for eligibility, and once those required data was pooled and scanned from the database, we have taken and it's a predefined data table, and for this study was conducted by two independent reviewers. They have taken data into different tables, they compiled, they extracted, they compared, and the third reviewer that tried to figure out all the discrepancies in these two findings what were found by these two independent reviewers. Methodological quality was assessed using Quadis tool. So here you will be able to see that we have taken these 818 plus 3 studies into consideration. these three 818 records, these 818 records we extracted from PubMed and three from Google. So inclusive of these, we had total 821 records. These were like the real studies, what we could figure out from PubMed. So we screened these records and then we have put our exclusion criteria. Using the exclusion criteria, what we already discussed, 670 articles were excluded. And then there were 151 full text articles were assessed for eligibility criteria. Out of those eligible articles, we again put our exclusion criteria. And the reasons for the exclusions we have already mentioned over here. We have taken these many studies into consideration. And out of 151, we could zero down only 11 studies wherein AI/ML was used for cancer diagnosis, which can be used for clinical decision making. Okay, and the performance of AI/ML was calculated on the basis of Cohen's Kappa and Microsoft Excel. So and for these three of the things, for article screening, for full text screening, and for inference, for three of the things, we have used like two independent reviewers for all the three things. Article screening was, these findings came out as 0.620, and same for full text screening, eligible assessment came out as 0.604. And the first authors of the 11 included studies came from 9 different countries. This is the methodological quality which is being assessed using Quadis tool. These are just few of the important characteristics which we'll be sharing here. In case if you see, out of these 11 studies, none of the studies have been conducted for cancer, for breast cancer. So what it shows? It shows wherein so much development is going for breast cancer, but none of the study have been published for breast cancer. Same way, in case if you see that, there is quite varied data what we could figure out, which is marked in red. This is the number of patients and this is the number of lesions studies. This is quite varied in number. What it shows, because the study have been done for healthy patients as well. If you'll see the diagnostic performance of the AI/ML protocol, when we said that it should be, everything should be higher in nature, we could figure out 72%, 68.5%, and 2.80% is quite low. In few of the results recommendations, results came out as nature of the AI/ML protocol. So we have used ANN, which is artificial neural network, for 4 of the studies out of 11, DLL followed by DLL with CNN for 2 studies, and so on. So that means out of those 11 studies, what we could zero down for our research, in most of them, ANN was used for 4 studies. In the scenario where the AI/ML protocol was used, we can see that most of the scenarios were in preoperative differentiating between benign and malignant tissues. Basically, for the skin cancer, most of the studies have been conducted for skin cancer and followed by cancers in the asymptomatic persons. Here you can see the type of cancer mentioned for all the studies. Skin cancer for 3 studies, colorectal for 2, cervical for 2, and so on. So basically these findings have been measured with respect to biopsy and histology, which have been considered as the gold standard. Now the comparison done in 8 out of 11 studies and what we could extract out of this outcome. AI/ML protocol was similar to human diagnosis. AI/ML protocol improves human diagnosis. AI/ML protocol is better than human diagnosis or variable outcome. So on this finding, we really need to see whether AI/ML can replace doctors or not. And for that, so here you will be able to see that in the validation studies, here we talked about the real world study, we could figure out only 11 studies out of those 821. In the validation studies, which are like 117 numbers, we can see actual results. Majorly studies have been done in the breast cancer followed by prostate cancer. Same way, nature of the AI/ML protocol, mostly artificial neural network have been used, followed by support vector machine and convoluted neural network. If you'll see the yearly trend, you can see that mostly studies have been done in 2001 to 2005. So what it shows, during this time, machine learning came into picture. So people were like really enthusiastic to use machine learning, and post that, there is not much validation studies which have been published. There may be studies which have been done, but they may not have been published. Okay, now the countries you can see majorly development have been done in USA, followed by China. In India, you can see only 4%, only 2% actual development is conducted in India. And here again, you can see that the patient's variations and lesion variations is really low to higher in number. So what all these stats are giving info? So that we need to see on the basis of observation, possible reasons, and see the observation is only 11 out of 821 of published studies have used AIML protocols for diagnostic decision. What can be the possible reasons? Either actual usage of AIML protocols in cancer diagnosis is not done. If done, may not be published. If published, so may not be in PubMed, because for our criteria, we use only PubMed into consideration. There may be other databases, there may be other conferences as well. So that means actual usage of AIML protocol in cancer diagnosis shows less than the stellar performance. Okay, so definitely there can be a publication bias. So what does that mean? Even if the findings are not good, they may not have been published. Okay, so now the second observation is AIML protocol have a potential to significantly improve upon the prevailing diagnostic capabilities. Yes. So how it can do that? So AIML can replace doctors. So the outcome is AIML can't replace doctors, but AIML with doctors will definitely replace doctors without AIML. Okay. So what we can say here is definitely in case if we'll see the global phenomena and the patient doctor ratio. So in India, for 10,000 patients, there is one government doctor. So after seeing this, we can relate that it's really tough for all the doctors to serve more patients in less time. With the help of AIML, what doctors can do? Their performance can enhance the way, I guess, Shaila, he has emphasized on that AIML can augment the performance of doctors and doctors will be able to serve more patients in less time. And in that way, this will result in improved patient outcomes. There is varied findings when it comes to AIML protocol versus human diagnosis. Far-fetched to claim that AIML protocols can replace human for diagnosis. This we already discussed. Performance of AIML protocol in validation studies is much better than in real-world studies. Definitely, there is a reason for selection bias. In case if we are selecting the data which will give us a customized result as per our choice, then definitely that will not be, the AIML will not be validated completely. So as long as what is the finding here, it has to be tested and quality assessed to come up in the market. And mismatches, a suspicious lesion is more often benign in real world than in a training setting. And other important observations are large number of validation tests, but fewer number of actual usage studies. Meaningful translation is lacking. Large variations in the number of sample sizes in validation tests. Lack of regulation in new diagnostic tests, unlike the stringent drug approval regulations. So what happens when a drug comes in the market? So there are different stages of the drug approval before it comes in the market. Same way, there should be regulation in AIML. Otherwise, what is happening? There are quite varied data which is being used to validate the AIML technology. And trustworthiness of the validation studies in the backdrop of their poor regulations. Other important observations is who will be responsible for false results due to AIML protocols. So can we make responsible open source or copywriting issues? There is a Melafine device which is basically used to cure melanoma. This came in the market in 2011, and because of its poor performance, people have started using this device. Majorly hospitals have stopped using this device in 2017. So what it shows, it basically shows the implication of the economical evaluation. So that means we need to judge the commercial performance of the technology when before it's coming in the market. So in case if AIML driven technology have been developed and when it's coming in the market, before that it should be commercially evaluated, there should be economical evaluation should be done. And on that basis, it should come in the market. So there is another example of IBM Watson. You can see that IBM Watson, it came up to cure the oncology and it got canceled after 62 million of investment. Okay? And what their product was doing, they were giving unsafe treatment recommendations. There are different challenges of implementing AIML. We all know that data scarcity, which is shortage of data. So even though data is available nowadays, see, definitely we are no more in the dancing bear state, wherein the data is not at all available. We have come long way from that, and we definitely need to pace with the technology, because technology is running on a very fast pace. If we'll not be on the same pace, then definitely we'll be beaten by it. So data scarcity is one problem, and over the period of time, we do feel that we are trying to overcome with this. Data sharing. So what is happening basically, in case if you see that for AIML innovations, only startups and few researchers, they are trying to come up with such innovations. Definitely big giants like Amazon, Google, Microsoft, so these companies are either acquiring them or they are getting in collaboration with them. But when it comes to the data sharing, sometimes it becomes really tough for such startups to get the required real world data to do their validation or testing for such products. So data sharing becomes really important, and we should consider this as our right to share data in case if hospitals or other organizations are having real world data with them. Computational and AIML skills among healthcare workers. So what is happening basically, scientist workers, they are having scientific knowledge, but they may not be having computational knowledge like R, Python, like technical knowledge basically. And when it comes to the medical field, they don't have computational knowledge. So medical people, they do feel that their research is complete, and technical people, they do feel that their product is working really well. But the reality somewhere comes in between, and we need to figure out, they both need to go hand in hand. So in case if one person is having computational knowledge, they don't have the scientific knowledge, they need to collaborate with the medical scientist. And the medical scientist need to collaborate with the computer scientist to take the use of their technical knowledge. Sense of mistrust among doctors. AI cannot substitute for a human physicians. Definitely not. It has to be balanced. And way ahead is, researchers should publish their experience in actual usage of AML protocol in cancer diagnosis. Because what is happening, out of these 821 studies, we could figure out only 11 studies we can take into consideration for our research, but there may be many studies which have been done but may not have been published, and because of that we could not take them into consideration. So researchers should publish most of their studies. Need for collaboration between AIML scientists and medical scientists. And validation studies are not conclusive proof of working in real world. Stronger regulations needed, the way it's there in the drug approval industry. And AIML products replacing physicians, better to aim for AIML products improving physicians' diagnosis. So that's all from my side.